Hi everyone, thanks for being here. My name is Mayo Amusat. I'm a part of the Integrated Data Frameworks group, where we build models and tools that allow us to process raw data into usable formats for scientific analysis. I'm a second year postdoc here, and I've been working on a number of DOE funded projects to improve energy generation and water desalination systems. Today, I'll be talking about some work I've been doing on developing data-driven models for equation-oriented optimization. But first, an introduction to IDES. IDES is a DOE-funded collaborative effort between a number of universities and national labs. The aim is to develop next-generation computational tools to enable the rapid design and optimization of chemical systems. Historically, there have been two types of tools for designing process systems which have sort of developed independently. On the one hand, we have algebraic modeling languages in which you're able to actually write your equations fully and the system is fully extensible. On the other hand, we have simulation packages in which you can only select from within the model libraries that are available. Everything else is closed to the user. While both of these tools have been sufficient in the past, going forward, if we are going to develop innovative state-of-the-art chemical processes, then we need to develop a novel set of capabilities which bridge the gap between algebraic modeling languages and simulation packages. And the IDES framework is being developed to do exactly this. While the IDES framework was originally focused on power plant design, it has been shown to be adaptable and applicable to other areas such as water desalination. So IDES is being developed to design and optimize chemical processes like the one shown on the top right here. Key to this idea is the concept of equation-oriented optimization. In equation-oriented optimization, the model equations for all the units within your system are collected and solved using gradient-based solution methods. This is usually done using an algebraic modeling language. One of the things that makes IDES unique is that it builds an extensible equation-oriented model library on top of an algebraic modeling language. IDES is built on top of PyOMO, which is an algebraic modeling language for formulating equation-oriented optimization problems. PyOMO interfaces with a number of linear and nonlinear optimization solvers, which allows it to solve large-scale optimization problems. This approach has been tremendously successful in the past. Now, while this approach to optimization is very good for getting solutions and solving large problems, some challenges still exist. The figure shown here is representative of the type of problem we are trying to solve in IDES. It is a flowsheet of a typical coal-fired power plant. Each of these symbols represents a different unit within the power plant. So for example, the circles are heat exchangers and the trapezoids are turbines. Each of these units have their own models and all the models need to be optimized simultaneously. The algorithms we use to solve these types of problems usually require that the flowsheet is evaluated thousands, sometimes millions of times. Therefore, the speed of the individual models is actually a priority. When your models are simple, this is not a problem. However, in some cases, your models are actually high fidelity or CFD models, very expensive to evaluate computationally. For example, in this figure, we have a coal-fired boiler, which is highlighted in red here. Boilers typically have 3D multiphysics behavior and are usually represented by CFD models. However, a single run of the CFD model of the boiler might take about a minute, so running 1,000 or 10,000 iterations with it during optimization is not realistic. So the question then becomes, how do we speed up the solution of large-scale optimization problems involving computationally expensive submodels? This is the research question I've been working on addressing. One potential solution to this challenge, which is what I've been exploring, is to use simple surrogate models as approximations of the true high-fidelity model. Surrogate models are low-order representations of a system that allow us to evaluate its behavior fairly quickly and to an acceptable degree of accuracy. The advantage of addressing this problem using surrogates is that, other than computationally expensive submodels, they also allow us to incorporate information from systems that are difficult to represent algebraically. For example, surrogates allow us to represent experimental data and pilot scale data and legacy simulations in a form that can be handled by equation-oriented systems like IDES. However, integrating surrogate models into an algebraic modeling framework is not straightforward. There are some unique challenges that we need to address. Here, I show the framework I've developed for using surrogates in algebraic modeling systems. Given the true process system that we are interested in, we first need to isolate the high fidelity model that we are trying to emulate. Once the system has been isolated, we need to generate a surrogate for that system and then replace the high fidelity model within the process problem with that surrogate. We then need to maintain a feedback loop that allows us to validate the performance of the surrogate against the high fidelity model. Each of the stages in this workflow has its own challenges. In going from the high fidelity model to the surrogate, there are two things we need: sampling and surrogate training. However, due to the nature of algebraic modeling systems, we cannot just select any surrogate type. Our surrogates need to meet some very specific requirements. I'll focus on just two of those requirements here. The first is that, since we are talking about algebraic optimization, we must be able to represent our surrogates as algebraic equations. We also need to be able to get gradient information and Hessian information from the surrogates, since the plan is for us to use them with gradient-based optimization algorithms. Of course, the surrogates also need to be tractable and data efficient, especially since our surrogates depend on us running the true model. Once the surrogate is ready, we also then need to address the problem of integrating the surrogate into the algebraic system workflow for optimization. This also has its own challenges. First, we must somehow take these surrogates and convert them into a form that the algebraic modeling language can understand. Once this is done, we then need to ensure that the integration occurs automatically and seamlessly. This is important because we may need to train the surrogate multiple times or try out different surrogate types, for example. My research has centered around developing tools, workflows, and pipelines to address all of these challenges. To explain the work I've been doing, I'll walk through a typical example. I'll focus on the simulation of a carbon dioxide turbine in a power plant. We are interested in the behavior of the entire power plant, and the accuracy of the turbine has the most impact on the power output. When we run the turbine in a flow sheet, the inlet conditions of the turbine are actually going to be known, since they are coming from another unit. However, that information only becomes available after we've run the turbine within the full power system. We know nothing about the conditions of the turbine at the exit or downstream of this. Let's keep this in mind. Typically, to simulate a turbine, we need to be able to evaluate the thermodynamic properties of the operating fluid, in this case carbon dioxide, over the entire range of conditions within the system. The properties of fluids are usually given by a PVT diagram, and the one for carbon dioxide is shown on the left here. Just from looking at it, it is clear that the behavior of carbon dioxide depends on the region you are interested in. The PVT surface tells us how real substances actually behave, and knowing any two of the three properties, that is volume, pressure or temperature, allows the third to be predicted exactly and corresponds to an exact state of the fluid. So CO2 is a gas in this region, a liquid in this region, and a solid in this region. In other areas of the PVT space, we have a mixture of states. These PVT diagrams are represented in equation form by equations of state, and the one for carbon dioxide is the Spang-Wagner equation of state shown on the right here. The equation has a lot of terms and is highly nonlinear, with a number of exponentials and natural logs. On top of the complexity of the equation itself, to get the properties we desire, which are the enthalpy and the entropy, we actually need to take some derivatives of the equations. So the question we need to ask ourselves is, can we make this problem more tractable and get good solutions by replacing this equation of state with surrogates for the thermodynamic properties that we actually need? To generate surrogate models for the thermodynamic properties, first we need training data from within our region of interest. The PVT diagram shows the behavior of carbon dioxide over the entire temperature, pressure, volume spectrum. However, because we are simulating a supercritical turbine, we are only interested in the supercritical region of the PVT space, which is shown in red here. Our problem is two-dimensional, and we know the minimum and maximum temperatures and pressures which can occur within our system, so this defines our sampling region. We selected some sampling points from within this region and then evaluated the enthalpy and entropy values using the Spang-Wagner equation of state. An example of the model training data we selected for entropy is shown here. The two input values are shown on the X and Y axis, while the entropy is shown on the Z axis. In this example, we have used the Hammersley sampling technique. However, we have discovered that different types of sampling methods represent different types of phenomena when generating surrogates, so we have implemented a number of sampling methods. So for example, uniform grid sampling is good for constraint modeling because it places points at the corners of the design space, while Hutton sampling has been shown to be well suited to incremental sampling. We needed tools that allowed us to be able to either generate samples from scratch or select samples from datasets. The sampling process was made more difficult by the fact that the tools needed to be plug and play. We needed to be able to swap out one method for another without having to change models or the pipelines significantly. The next step is then to train the surrogate. For this problem, we have considered polynomial models. we have developed a tool for generating polynomial models. A big part of our focus in developing surrogate rules for optimization was to give users a lot of control over the form and the complexity of the models. With our polynomial tool, for example, in addition to the conventional univariate and bilinear terms in the polynomial models, we have developed the capability for the user to define their own custom terms as part of the model. This final bit allows the user to incorporate both physics-based knowledge and solver-specific knowledge. For example, somebody dealing with a wave or sound-related problem might know that a sinusoidal behavior is expected in their function based on experience, so they could choose to add some trigonometric functions to the polynomial as a way to incorporate this knowledge into the process. This level of control provided to the user allows the user to make the surrogates as simple or as complicated as they actually want it to be. For the example, we generated surrogates for the enthalpy and the entropy. For brevity, again, I'll focus on just the entropy. We obtained a fourth order polynomial for the entropy. The surface represented by the model is shown here on the right. The red circles are the training points, while the surface is the surrogate model. The maximum deviation we observed from the true data was under 5 joules per mole, and the normalized root mean square error was under 2%, so the surrogate appears to be representing the training data well. Similar results were obtained for the enthalpy. Here, we've chosen a polynomial model because of the low dimensionality of the problem and the fact that just plotting the training points suggested to us that the problem was of low complexity. However, we have also worked with and developed model types that are suited to highly nonlinear systems like Kriging and radial basis functions, and we have developed workflows for these types of surrogates as well. What the surrogate thermodynamic package allows us to then do is to be able to simulate the entire flowsheet. The figure here just shows what the full power plant flowsheet with the turbine looks like. The surrogate supplies the properties required for all the streams present in this process. For this to be able to work, we had to be able to go from the surrogate to an algebraic model that was usable for equation-oriented optimization in IDEAS. We had to convert the surrogates from simple data structures and Python objects into algebraic equations that could be used by the AML, that is PyOMO. We addressed this challenge by developing surrogate to PyOMO translation modules that will take in the variables as defined by PyOMO, create an algebraic expression of the surrogates with those variables that could be evaluated, and then return a result that will be understandable and translatable by PyOMO. Because IDEAS itself is built on top of PyOMO, converting the surrogates into PyOMO expressions meant that we could ensure seamless and automatic integration into the IDEAS framework. Once this was done, we were able to simulate the full plant with our surrogates. Our turbine is highlighted in yellow here. We compared the values we got with the surrogate results in literature for the same problem. The values in the red boxes show the errors in the results of some of the units. As you can see, the maximum error for the units we are displaying here is about 4.5%, so our surrogates are not doing badly. It should be noted that the turbine, which is the unit around which this surrogate package was designed, shows an error of just over 1%. There are two takeaway points here. First, the surrogates estimate the net power to within 8% of the true value, so they appear to be sufficient for estimating system performance. The surrogates have allowed us to be able to solve the entire flowsheet relatively quickly and to a reasonable accuracy, which we will struggle to do if we actually use the full EOS model. Secondly, this example demonstrates one of the key strengths of IDEAS. We were able to select most of the units from model libraries while actually writing our own equations for the properties. Having simulated the entire process, we now have some information about the inlet conditions that should be expected into the turbine, and we can therefore verify how accurate our surrogates actually are. Now we have some information about the exact conditions around the inlet of the turbine. To validate the results we got with the surrogates, we need to simulate the turbine with the true properties, that is the Spanwagner model, using the turbine inputs we now have, and then compare the results to what we got with the surrogates. We fixed the inlet conditions of the turbine and had the model predict the power output and outlet temperature using the true EOS model. The results we obtained are shown in the table on the right. Of particular interest here are the results shown in the last column highlighted in red. The agreement between the results for the outlet temperature and the power output with both models is excellent, under 7%. This gives us some measure of confidence in the accuracy of our predictions of the turbine performance. We adopted a similar verification approach for some of the other units within the flowsheet, and we saw good agreement. What this tells us is that we've been able to solve the entire power plant problem without having to resort to the EOS model during optimization. The approach and workflow described here can and have been applied to other optimization problems with some success. One of the products of the work that I've been doing is that we've developed a library for doing all of this within IDEAS. We've called the library PISMO, Python Surrogate Modeling Objects. The library is built into IDES on top of Paiomo, which allows us to take advantage of Paiomo's gradient-based servers and optimization capabilities. The library implements a number of the tools needed for generating accurate surrogates and integrating them into IDES. So among other things, tools for sampling, tools for data scaling, and tools for surrogate generation. The library provides a breadth of capabilities suitable for a variety of scientific problems. In conclusion, regression-oriented optimization is a powerful technique for understanding and improving complex systems such as power plants and other chemical processes. And while high fidelity models can pose some problems when introduced into regression-oriented systems, replacing these high fidelity models with quick-to-evaluate surrogates can help us to solve any speed and tractability challenges that we may encounter. Surrogates also allow us to be able to pull in information from other non-algebraic sources such as experimental data and black boxes. And finally, the PISMU library provides a suite of sophisticated, user-friendly, and effective methods for sampling and fitting data from high-fidelity models and experiments. It interfaces directly with a number of algebraic modeling tools like IDES and Paiomo, and is suitable for different types of scientific problems, both within and outside of the process engineering space. I would like to acknowledge all members of the IDES team, particularly everyone involved in the development and testing of PISMU, so Dangonta and Debagawa here, and a number of other folks at other national labs. Thanks for listening, and I'm happy to take any questions.